Hi, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
Today, we're continuing our series where we do a deep dive into each of the Myers-Briggs personality types. Today's personality is the ISFP personality in the Myers-Briggs system, or the authenticity sensation personality in the Personality Hacker system.
Yeah, and in our personal lives, we are swimming in ISFPs.
Yes.
Yeah, your father is an ISFP.
That's correct.
Our sister-in-law is an ISFP. Your ex-wife is an ISFP. So it seems like we've got them everywhere.
And growing up, I had ISFPs around me a lot.
Yeah, you were in a context that had a lot of the ISFP personality type. And it's given us a really interesting insight into how this type shows up, how they behave, some of the ways in which they experience the world. And we got some excellent responses on our survey, like some of the highest quality responses of any of the surveys, I would say. I think the people who responded to the survey put so much thought and attention and just their personal story into the survey responses. It was a gold mine to us. And so before we started this podcast, you know, we go over the survey questions or answers, and we really talk about, you know, some of the things that have been our observations. And I think just having those survey answers alone helped me flesh out some of my preconceived notions about ISFP. So I'm pretty excited about this podcast. And I think there's a couple insights that became clear to us as we were going through, you know, our experience of ISFPs and some of the survey responses and just some of the things that we've kind of come up with on our own. I think there's some really great insights in here. So I'm pretty excited about it. And I would love to get right into the CAR model.
Absolutely. So you've probably been following along with some of the other personality types we've been talking about. We use a metaphor of the mind. We use a metaphor of the car, a car with a driver, a passenger, and two people in the back seat as a way to look at how your mind is wired, how your personality shows up. So as an ISFP, and by the way, if you want a reference, a visual reference of this CAR model, head over to personalityhacker.com and just search CAR model. There's an article there with a visual representation so you could follow along with what we're talking about.
Right. And the CAR model is a metaphor for what is technically called the cognitive function stack.
Yeah.
So these are the mental processes that influence your personality type more than anything else. And the CAR model is just a way to make it really accessible and understandable with what, you know, a lot of people might think is kind of confusing. What are these cognitive functions? So these are the mental processes that influence you the most, and the CAR model is an easy way to understand them.
Yes. As an ISFP, your personality, in the driver's seat of your personality, is a mental process. The technical name, again, is cognitive function. And the technical name of that cognitive function is introverted feeling. We've nicknamed it authenticity. This is what drives your personality. And this is how you show up as an ISFP to the world. This is the strength you bring. And this is what puts you in flow every day by showing up with this authenticity process. Now, authenticity is a decision-making process. It decides how you're going to make a decision about everything that you make a decision about in your life. And it fundamentally asks the question, what feels right to me as a person in my gut, in my heart, at the core of my being? What feels right? What resonates with me? And what do I think the right thing to do, or the core resonant thing to do, is in this situation? That's the primary question that authenticity is asking.
Well, and the reason why that becomes its evaluative criteria is because introverted feeling is all about feeling on the inside. How am I feeling about things? It's about being really in touch with how each experience is impacting you on a subjective level. So it's very personal. It's very introspective. You can imagine that if every single thing that you have experienced through life, the first thing you register is how it is making you feel, how it's impacting your identity, how it's informing your ethics and your convictions. You can imagine that things, you would take everything personally. And I don't even mean like in a negative way.
Or a defensive way.
Right. I don't mean like you're overly sensitive and you're taking everything, you know, as an insult. I mean, you're just simply personalizing everything you experience. It's all about how it's impacting you on a core subjective level.
Yeah, so as a kid, you watch your mom and dad maybe in an argument or a fight, and maybe your mom yells at your dad, and you say, man, if I was my dad, this is how I'd be feeling about that. So you start to feel the personal feeling of what it would be like to be yelled at by another person in a relationship, for example, how that makes you feel impacted on the inside. Or every experience you go, maybe in school, you go through your school experience as a teenager and, you know, something happens in the classroom and there's some discomfort or there's some excitement or whatever's happening there emotionally, you're resonating and you're saying, okay, how does this experience make me feel internally? Going through this and seeing this play out, how do I feel about this in my core?
So just like with anything that we spend a lot of time thinking about or experiencing, we get really nuanced with that thing. All of us get a high level of nuance and proficiency in our driver process, especially if we spend time exercising it, not simply utilizing it or using it. An exercise means that we're making the skill better over time. So you can imagine that anybody who leads with this authenticity process gets to a place where they can see a wide spectrum of parts of who they are. They can see almost everything. And I believe it was in the INFP podcast that we talked about how authenticity or introverted feeling can even see the dark parts of who we are. It experiences this huge spectrum of emotions and, you know, styles of being and identities and the dark parts of us and the light parts of us. And you can see how this would become very interested, this process would become very interested in concepts around ethics and how we should be treating each other and what's the right thing to do and what's the wrong thing to do, because each situation has an impact on a person in a very subjective way. And so how should we be behaving towards each other? How should I be showing up? So you can see how the evaluation or the evaluative criteria would very quickly come to what feels right to me. When I search this huge spectrum of who I am, when I search all of my subjective experiences and how they impacted me and how they shaped me and my identity, then how we behave towards each other becomes very intriguing, very interesting, and very important. Now, one of the things that I saw come up in the survey over and over again for ISFPs was this struggle of self-expression. How do I get all this stuff inside of me, all the stuff that is beyond language, it's just pure emotional feeling, it's just a pure experience within me. How do I help other people understand all of these layers, all of these things that are going on simultaneously, all the complexity of who I am? How can I possibly express that to another person? So personal expression and self-expression, again, become very interesting to a person of this type. Now, what they can't just be inside of themselves, just like none of us can survive with just one cognitive function or just one mental process. And that's why we all need, every single personality type needs a co-pilot. For ISFPs, the thing that rounds them out and makes them more balanced as individuals is that they supplement that authenticity driver with a co-pilot that we've nicknamed sensation. Its technical name is extroverted sensing. Now, extroverted sensing or sensation is a perceiving process or a way of understanding and learning information and understanding the world. If you want a deeper dive into what this looks like, I recommend listening to the podcast on the sensing personality types, and we do a bit of a deep dive into sensation. But sensation is all about real-time information. It's what's coming at you in the moment using all of your senses. And so that means being present, being here and now, being in the moment, really feeling things in a kinesthetic way through your body. That becomes the most interesting piece of information to an ISFP. What's going on right here, right now? What's verifiable? What can I personally experience and touch? Now, when you marry these two things together, self-expression, trying to help other people understand the complexity of who you are as a person and as an individual, really wanting to connect with other people and talk about these things that are so important to you and things you feel very convicted about. Combining that with a very grounded, very in-the-moment way of engaging with the world, like sensation, that generally tends to produce some of the greatest art that we know of, right? This art that gets expressed in a physical, tangible way. So it can be painting, or it could be, you know, being a chef and creating food. It could be dance and performance art. It can be music. Most ISFPs, one of the things that I do as a profiler, when I'm suspecting that the person might be an ISFP and I'm kind of maybe struggling a little bit to try to figure out what their type is, one of the questions I ask them is, Do you feel on some level, even if you're not professionally this way, do you feel on some level that you're an artist? And I have yet to have an ISFP say no. Every ISFP I've ever asked that has said, yes, I see myself as an artist.
Or at least are you attracted to artistic expression or some way of expressing yourself through the arts or through communicating in that way?
Exactly. Although, I mean, literally, I say, do you think of yourself as an artist in some way? And every single one has said yes so far. Now, of course, there's going to be exceptions to the rule. Somebody who's listening may be an ISFP that goes, I don't see myself as an artist. And even then, I might question, is it a permission thing? Is it really an identity thing that I'm not an artist? Or is it actually that you feel that being an artist would be too cool and you're not allowed to say that you're an artist? ISFPs generally see themselves as artists in some form. Now, what happens is the world loves art and at the same time doesn't love an artist. I think ISFPs experience something that is not uncommon to a lot of intuitive types, which is that the idealization of them is a lot more acceptable to other people than the reality of them. Because ISFPs are not here to do the efficient thing. They're not here to build systems that everybody benefits from. They're here to create and help us replicate emotional experiences that we may never be able to access in any other way other than the art that is produced. And that feels really inefficient to us. And in an efficiency and effectiveness obsessed culture like we live in, ISFPs can feel very marginalized. They can feel like the thing that they bring to the world is not acceptable. And if they pursue self-expression in a way that is extroverted, right, using extroverted sensing or sensation, if they pursue something and they get knocked down over and over again, and they are sensitive to that, sometimes they retreat to the 10-year-old process, which is technically called introverted intuition, or what we call perspectives. Now, the way that perspective shows up when it is a strength is it's the ability to shift inside other people's perspective. It's the ability to forecast a future pace. It's the ability to imagine new worlds and see huge terrains within you. Now, an ISFP has quite a bit of access to this mental process since it's the 10-year-old in their car. It's in their cognitive function stack. And if they feel that going out in the world and exposing themselves to censure is too painful, sometimes they will completely miss that co-pilot process of sensation and just live in what's called the introverted feeling, introverted intuition loop, or what we call the authenticity perspectives loop. Now, this can be dangerous terrain. And the reason why is if you only ever spend time inside of yourself, if you only ever spend time introspecting and projecting a world and spending time in imagination and how things are making you feel, you can get to a level of idealization that simply cannot play out in the outside world. And so the outside world always becomes hostile. It always becomes a territory that you are trying to protect yourself against. And this is why ISFPs can sometimes become martyrs. They can sometimes see themselves as victims and always at effect as opposed to at cause. Everybody's out to get them. Nobody understands who they are. Nobody could possibly understand any of the things that they experience. And this sense of victimization means that every time they attempt to do something in the outside world, they're bringing with them all this idealization. It has to look a certain way. It's got to be perfect. The outside world has to match what they're imagining inside of themselves, which is unrealistic. Now, there's nothing wrong with being unrealistic to a certain extent, right? Like, if it is your talent to be an idealist, if it's your talent to want to bring something extraordinary from inside of yourself to the outside world, even if it never 100% happens, that friction, that struggle of wanting to have other people completely understand what's happening inside of yourself and never quite getting there, well, that's basically the foundation of art. So that's okay. Like, coming to terms with the fact that we will never be able to ever produce in the outside world something as fleshed out or as rich as your inner experience, coming to terms with that is a good thing. And constantly trying, despite the fact that that can't happen, is a good thing too, because it's the struggle of trying that gets us closer and closer to extraordinary art. So that's not a bad thing. But it's when the person hasn't come to terms with that. It's when that is too crushing for them. What they end up doing is hiding away from the world. And that hiding away from the world means that there's a lot of insecurity that gets born in there. There's a lot of inability to see what they can bring, right? Like, it's, if you never quite produce anything, if you never are able to look at that thing and go, I did that, that's mine, that's the thing that I did. If you're never able to escape that inner world long enough to build skill and to become a better version of yourself, then you can deal with crippling insecurity. And I think that that piece, that insecurity, that lack of self-esteem is something that's very common for ISFPs, and that's a major struggle that they deal with. How do I come to terms with myself? How do I know that I'm okay? How do I deal with maybe my indecisiveness or my lack of self-worth? How do I deal with all of this in a world that will never quite reflect back to me all the extraordinary texture that I experience within myself?
The final piece in that car model for you as an ISFP, part of your personality, is what we call the three-year-old position. Its technical name is extroverted thinking. That's the cognitive function you're using. That's the function you're using. And we've nicknamed it effectiveness. Now, effectiveness is all about getting things done and making things happen in the external world. So it's, you know, setting up project management, deadlines, accomplishing tasks, manipulating pieces of information, tracking metrics, you know, just basically getting things done in the outside world is what effectiveness is all about. Now, we live in a culture that honors effectiveness and effectiveness thinking like crazy. You know, accomplishing things, hitting metrics. If you work in a business, you probably have like key performance indicators you have to match or make. And everybody wants to know what the bottom line is. What's the numbers? What are we getting out of this? What works? What's effective? For you as an ISFP, this is a blind spot. This is something that is not one of your talents. In fact, this is something that you have a blind spot around and can be a struggle for you living in a world that expects you to show up with this as an ability of yours. This is just simply something that you're not that great at. Now, you can obviously get things done. You can obviously accomplish tasks in the world, but on a sophisticated level of like building business systems and thinking on long timelines of, you know, tasks and when they have to get done and project management, if you killed yourself, you probably could be okay at that, but it's just something that's not interesting to you. It's something you have no desire for. You don't enjoy it. It feels icky when you have to be in this space. And in fact, it is something that you would most likely try to avoid at all costs.
Yeah, effectiveness is very much about building systems that are, they remove the human component. That subjective human component that you're so in touch with, effectiveness does not want to have to make that a part of the system. It wants to set it and forget it. So effectiveness, when done extremely well, sets up really comprehensive systems that are one size fits all. They try, I mean, a really, really good effectiveness system may have some wiggle room for an individual, but for the most part, it's set it and forget it. And that can be really offensive to an authenticity person, because what about the exception to the rule? What about my individuality? What about my personal experience? I don't like having to engage with something that's so depersonalized. One example we had of this is, we know an ISFP who, in the part of the world that we live in, there is becoming more and more common fast food and takeout that is ordered from touchscreen monitors, right? Like, you don't actually interact with a human being. You just put your order into a touchscreen. And so obviously they can't like take into account every possible modification. So you can modify it to some extent, but for the most part, you kind of get what you get. Like, you order a sandwich and you can say whether or not you want mayonnaise on it, but you can't say how much mayonnaise you want it, that kind of thing. And I remember an ISFP talking about how much he hated those. He hated those because you can't talk to an individual. You can't talk to a person. You're just you're punching buttons into this, you know, depersonalized machine. You're not actually engaging with the person and being able to tell them exactly how much of each thing that you want in your sandwich. And so it's that mentality. It's not that an ISFP can't get things done like you mentioned. It's that they're not good at setting up these depersonalized systems that you can just run on their own.
So let's shift back to what we first started talking about with the two front seat parts of the car. We're talking about authenticity and we're talking about that co-pilot of sensation. And one of the things we harp on here at Personality Hacker, we talk about all the time, is getting into the co-pilot of your personality. For you as an ISFP, this is that sensation process. And the reason why we talk about this so much is because all of us have a tendency to skip past our co-pilot and go directly to our 10-year-old process for either making decisions or learning information. For you as an ISFP, this is how you see the world using your co-pilot and your 10-year-old process. It's very easy for you because you're an introvert. You spend time in your inner world. Authenticity is an internal process. It's about how you feel internally and subjectively. It's very easy when you're in that internal state to shift, and instead of seeing the world externally through that sensation process, getting outside yourself and seeing everything in a sensory way, it's very easy for you to go to that 10-year-old of perspectives and begin to project onto the outside world a perspective of how you idealize and see the world as it should be. And it's a great connection with that authenticity part of you. Now you get caught, what Antonia talked about, that loop earlier. You get caught in that authenticity perspectives loop. You start projecting out into the world what you want the reality to be. And then inside your heart, that authenticity part process starts to say, yeah, that feels right to me. That's how the world should be. That's how the world is. That's how the world seems to be for me. And I feel it so strongly. Well, the challenge in this is if you start from the internal experience of that 10-year-old process of perspectives, and you paint a picture of an ideal scenario and situation, and it doesn't play out in the outside world, you start to retreat even more. You start to get more inwardly focused, and you double down on this idealized projection of how the world should be.
Well, one of the biggest problems with that is it interrupts your relationships with other people. And anytime we project outward an idealization of how we want the world to be that is not possible in the outside world, then we're everything is always going to fall short. We are going to be perpetually dissatisfied.
Yeah.
Like the world will never match up to how we want it to be. And if a part of that idealization is that nobody ever understands you because the outside world can never reflect back to you the texture of what's going on inside of you that authenticity sees, then every relationship you have will just be a reflection back of how little other people understand you, how little other people know you, how little they're taking you into account. So the antidote to this is making sure you get into that co-pilot process of sensation. Sensation is what grounds you. It's what allows you to check in with reality on a regular basis. Now, I don't think we want to indicate that being idealistic is a problem. I actually think in the social ecosystem, idealism is an important component. And there are a couple different personality types that help us reach out for ideals. The idealism that they bring is actually important for everybody because they help us reach out for something bigger. They help us reach for higher goals, higher purposes, something beyond what we currently experience. So it's not idealism itself that's the issue. It's how the idealism is constructed. And just like you mentioned, Joel, if you start with an internal calibration of the ideal, right? Like if you start with how you want things to be based on how they're making you feel in authenticity and the imagined possibilities of perspectives, then you can construct anything you want inside of yourself. You can literally construct any world that you can imagine inside of yourself. And if that becomes your ideal, you will always, always be dissatisfied with what reality can provide for you. However, if you create your idealism by first checking in with what reality has to offer, by getting out into the outside world and really checking in with reality and that concrete piece, by pursuing sensation things, by, you know, experiencing other people's differences of opinion, by experiencing how their ideals are different than your ideals, by seeing a bigger, broader world, by getting out into nature and really becoming one with nature, by understanding that there is a much, much, much bigger world out there than maybe you had even allowed yourself to understand, because the world that you always want to explore is your inner world, which is also a big world. But there's a big world outside of yourself too. And the more you understand how big that world outside of yourself is, and then let those inform and influence your ideals, now you're getting much closer to being able to actually see what you want to see realized in the outside world.
Yeah, an example of this in a real example is, let's say as an ISFP, you've got this inner ideal that you can fly without the use of a machine. is that a reality? I don't believe it's a reality in the world I live in. And I don't believe that people can fly without machines. Basically, the only place you're going to see that happen is in a comic book or some kind of a movie setting, right? It's not a real thing that we can fly without machines. However, if you notice something, you observe maybe a very wealthy person that's built a really great business living on an airplane and flying all over the world using their airplane like a motorhome almost, well, that is something that is actually tangible and realistic. I know this is a very simplistic example, but this is kind of the difference between an internal idealism and an external idealism, or something that's possible in the actual world. And I think this can be applied to a lot of things for you as an ISFP.
Yeah, it's allowing what is to inform that idealism, as opposed to only being imaginative in your idealism, which can never be attained. And if you're using real world examples, what is to influence your idealism, that is something that can be attained. And you can work really hard to get there. And you can make that happen for yourself. And so you don't have to be perpetually dissatisfied with reality. You can actually make a reality that matches your ideals, or your idealism rather, because you let reality inform what that idealism was to begin with. So it's a nuance, but it's an important one. And I think also when an ISFP allows the real world, what is, to influence their idealism, then they can work hard to get there, and they can see their hard work and the fruit that came from it. And this is where I think this is really the source of, no matter what personality type you are, it's the source of our self-esteem. We know we can make things happen. We know that we can attain the things that we want. And so a lot of the self-doubt, which comes from always being dissatisfied by the outside world and never being able to reach the things you want, like, that puts you in a perpetual state of self-doubt because, well, you can't make it happen. Like, the thing you want, you can never make happen. And so do you have competence? Do you have skill? Do you have any abilities? Whereas if you let the outside world inform your idealism and the things you go for, then those are attainable, and you can work hard and build skill and get competent and become the thing you need to be in order to reach those goals. And now you have self-worth. Now you have self-esteem. Now you understand that you have value and you can bring value to the world and make the things happen that you want to happen. And this actually makes up for the blind spot that you experience in the three-year-old of effectiveness. Because I've noticed an ISFP that is on target for a realistic ideal, right? An ideal that was influenced and informed by what can actually happen. I've noticed that when they're on target to do that, they are unstoppable. They're water. Like, you cannot block them from their goal. They will go up, over, around, through. They will do everything necessary to get to their end game. And it might not be the most efficient way of getting there, but they'll still get there. And so they make up for the blind spot of effectiveness, right? Building these systems and project management and ticking things off the to-do list. They make up for that blind spot by simply going for what they want and becoming a force to be reckoned with. But if you, on deep down inside, the marrow of your bones, know that the thing that you want can never be, why on earth would you ever attempt to go for it? Like, there's no motivation, because you know that the end is always disappointment. So really developing that co-pilot process of sensation is a massive leverage point as an ISFP for crafting the life that you really want.
So I think ISFPs have a superpower, and I think you as an ISFP have a superpower. I believe you, more than any other personality type, have the ability to help other people replicate emotions, and particularly strong emotions, whether they're good emotions, bad emotions, neutral emotions, whatever those are. You have the ability, through whether it's performance, self-expression, art, communication, music, dance, whatever form it takes, you have the ability to help other people replicate emotions in themselves. And this is really powerful. Can you imagine being on stage, being in front of an audience, or talking with people, or communicating, and helping other people feel strongly the ways that you feel as an ISFP? This is a superpower. And I don't want to undersell this at all. I want you to realize the power of this ability in you as an ISFP. This is really strong stuff.
Yeah. Most of us don't have access to that, especially those of us who don't use the authenticity process. We don't have access to understanding our emotional experience on that level. And we can get lost. We can get really lost with what we're feeling, why we're feeling it, like what's coming up for us, what's important to us. It can, I mean, as an accuracy person, I know that I can get really digital. I can get to a point where I really completely lose track of how I'm feeling and why I'm feeling it. And so being able to have the cathartic experience of listening to a song, like I remember when I was going through some massive grieving process for my sister's death, even if it wasn't music around losing somebody,
yeah,
right? Like even if it was just sad music, it was very cathartic for me. It was a way for me to access something that I was having trouble accessing on my own and being able to process it. Being able to read works of literature that help express complicated, complex emotions. Being able to, you know, look at works of art that help me think in terms that I may not have thought about before, like experience somebody else's suffering or grief or joy or whatever it is. And of course, those are all gross emotions. There are a lot more nuanced emotions in there. These works of art help us, those of us who are not artists, those of us who are not naturally gifted at getting inside our experience, these works of art help create a channel for us to understand parts of ourselves that we otherwise would not be able to understand. So like you, I don't want to devalue at all the gift that people of this personality type can bring to the world. And I always encourage ISFPs to ask themselves, what is their art? Even if it's not traditional art, even if it's not painting or music or whatever, there is some way that you are expressing yourself. It could be in how you dress. You could make your own clothes in order to fully express who you are. And I think that's the birthplace of a lot of fashion designers. You can, you know, be a person who just through like, it could be a mime and do it through by being a mime, right? Like there are so many different avenues of expression that help other people replicate these emotions and mirror back to them what they're going through. It's such an important thing that people of this personality type bring to the world.
You can tell us struggling to put words to how ISFPs can make us feel because it is experiential. It's about the emotion. It's about the experience. It's not about articulating the experience. It's about being in the experience. And that's, again, I think that's why ISFPs are so powerful at this, because they have that, especially if you as an ISFP are growing that sensation process, you're going to understand how to take the feelings, those deep core value feelings, that authenticity expression you have, and bring it into a tangible, physical, kinesthetic, outer display of that, that isn't going to be able to be put into words. I mean, you might be into poetry and put it into words, but it's to evoke, it's evocative, it's to evoke emotion, it's to get you to feel something. And I think you as an ISFP have that ability to make those strong, deep, internal, personal emotions experiential for other people outside of yourself. And that is a real, true superpower. So what do you think? How are you resonating with what we're talking about as an ISFP? I mean, we just scratched the surface, obviously, for your personality type. We haven't gotten to every possible angle of you. There is so much nuance to who you are, it's impossible to do that in one podcast. We want to hear from you. We want to hear what your experience has been. We want to hear what your emotions are, what your authenticity is telling you about this, what you're resonating with, what questions you might have. Come over to personalityhacker.com and leave your comments or questions directly below this podcast. We'd love to have a conversation online about some of these topics and continue to explore your personality here over at Personality Hacker.
If you like what you hear, you can subscribe to us on iTunes and various Android platforms. And if you're in a giving mood, please feel free to leave a rating and review on iTunes. Every rating and review helps us. It's based on iTunes' algorithm of certain amounts of rating and reviews help give us greater exposure. And so if you'd like to help us out, leaving a rating and review is a fantastic way to express reciprocity.
Absolutely. You can also find us on facebook.com/personalityhacker, twitter.com/personalityhack. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
Hey, we will talk with you on the next Personality Hacker podcast.